worship service with a song called Prince of Peace. It's kind of like back and forth between the gals and the guys. So hang on, and if you have to be singing with the guys you're singing, that's just fine. You a reverse. So we begin. Prince of Peace. You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will listen.
I will listen.
I will love you.
I will love you.
All of my days.
All of my days.
Guys, you sing this part. I will sing to and worship the King who is worthy. I will love and adore you. I will bow down before you. I will sing to and worship the King who is worthy. I will love and adore you. I will bow down before you. You are my Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you. Ladies, this is your part. You are Lord of Lords.
You are Lord of Lords. You are King of Kings. You are mighty God, Lord of everything. You're Emmanuel. You're the great I Am. You're the Prince of Peace, who is the Lamb. You're the living God. You're my saving grace. You will live forever. You are Ancient of Days. You are Alpha, Omega, beginning and end. You're my Savior, Messiah, Redeemer, and friend. You are my Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for
and
you.
And now we answer each other again. You are holy, God.
You are holy.
Guys, you are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Of all praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will listen.
I will listen.
I will love you.
I will love you.
All of my days.
All
now
of my days.
And the guys together. I will sing.
Lord of Lords, you are King of Kings. You are mighty God, Lord of everything. You're Emmanuel. You're the great I Am. You're the Prince of Peace, who is the Lamb. You're the living God. You're my saving grace. You will live forever. You are Ancient of Days. You are Alpha, Omega, beginning and end. You're my Savior, Messiah, Redeemer, and friend.
You are my Prince of Peace,
and I will live my life for you.
You are my Prince of Peace.
You are the Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you.
All right, good for you, good for you. Together we go with our call to worship. And I can't see those words very good anymore. So, Lisa, would you lead us with the...
No.
That's not the first time I've heard no. Where's Tim? Tim, rescue us then, would you?
No.
I'm going to go have a cup of coffee.
Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the evil man his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord and he will have mercy on him. And to our God, for he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than yours, and my thoughts than your thoughts.
Who are we that you would be mindful of us? What do you see that's worth looking our way? We are free in ways that we never should be. Sweet release from the grip of these chains. Life hinges straining from the weight. My heart no longer can keep from singing. All that is within me cries for you. Chains are gone, Emmanuel, God with us. Lord, you know our hearts don't deserve your glory. Still you show love we cannot afford. Hinges straining from the weight, my heart no longer can keep from singing. All that is within me cries for you alone, be glorified, Emmanuel, God with us. My heart sings song. The dead is paid, these chains are gone, Emmanuel, God with us.
Lord, you know, such a tiny offering,
such a tiny offering, compared to Calvary, nevertheless, we lay it at your feet. Such a tiny offering compared to Calvary. Nevertheless, we lay it at your feet. All that is within me cries for you alone, be glorified, Emmanuel, God with us. My heart sings a brand new song, the dead is paid, these chains are gone.
Good song. Good to have you here at Harbor of Joy this morning. Just want to say a little something to those that are on Zoom. I know there's somebody down in Arizona, first cousin of mine, and we take pity on you because of the heat that you are enduring down there, but we have smoke up here from Canada. So I just want to welcome you from down in that way. And I think heat rises, so even if you go to the mountains to live in the summer, remember, heat rises. You probably don't get away from much. Good to have you here today. And One, Denny Strzok, they give a little announcement this morning before I give more announcements. Go ahead, Denny.
You've probably seen some of the signs on the doors. This is a result of a number of people asking about security concerns. So the safety committee met with both local and regional guidance, our insurance company, authorities on the subject, and we had one of the local officers walk through the building and make some suggestions. So we formulated a plan, submitted it to the council Tuesday night, they approved it, and basically, once the service starts, all the doors will be locked except for the main doors, which will be monitored. We're also getting security cameras on the doors, and they'll record both the motion sensor and for security. If you have any questions, talk to Cheryl Meyer or Karen Sunday or me, and we can answer any questions. But we have a security plan. The statistics say it's very minimal. There's very little danger, but fear can be a powerful motivator. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Yep, thank you, Denny. Just want you to know that you can get out any door. The door will lock behind you. So just if you're going like, okay, it means we can't get out of here, we all got to come through the front door. No, you can go out any door you want because the doors will lock behind you. If you want to get back in, then somebody's got to let you in. So keep that in, just keep that in mind. Do want to let you know that, hey, there's birthdays this month and there's been weddings. We have a newlywed here today. I won't say who she is or he is. I take that back, I will. Mick and Allison. Allison is the daughter to Dave and Sarah Reef. They got married this month, right? Up in Spearfish, South Dakota. So welcome, glad that you're here today. Congratulations. And it was Chuck Teelber's birthday on Friday. He turned 89. I can say that because he's a guy. And he's in the hospital. He's in room 32. Went there by ambulance on Friday night. I hope it wasn't his homemade ice cream that did him in. But I had two bowls, and I'm fine. So he's there. Dean Ramsey was in the ER yesterday. He kind of fell down and was out at the lake, and he got x-rays, and he's okay. I think he caught himself, so he got a little sprained wrist type of thing, but he's not here today, but he's got a lot of things going on. Everything's fine with him, and he got to go home. But Chuck and Donna are there in the hospital. And this week, too, I mean, Dale Garrels is getting a knee replacement. Aren't you? It was on Tuesday. Lots of ice. Make sure you get lots of ice. And don't let the pain get ahead of you. My wife has had both knees done, so know what that's all about. Bob Griffiths got home, I believe, yesterday. I don't think he's here, but he's back home. So if you're gonna send a card, send it local. Or stop by. Nancy.
Two birthdays yesterday. We celebrated with Johnny Lehman from Pennsylvania.
Yep.
She turned 23. And Kathy Anderson had a birthday yesterday, too.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're just going to sing happy. It's Wayne's birthday today?
Today.
Hey, I know it's Pat Knutson's birthday coming up as well. Let's just sing happy birthday to everybody.
Birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday dear friends, happy birthday to you.
Oh, that's not now. Sorry.
Take it away, Bob. Wow.
Seemed like a good song.
Just some other announcements, kind of hurry on here, is just this Wednesday, we do have Wednesday it's Wednesday night fellowship here at 6:00. Keep that in mind. Pioneer Days starts on next Saturday at 11:00. We will have a float in that. Look for the van that's pulling a boat. and I'll be in the boat, and I don't know who else will be in there, but we often kind of throw things out. It won't be Bings, put it that way. It won't be Bings, but it'll be something thrown out. So if you see us come by, just yell loud, and if we hear you, we'll get you something thrown in your direction. We also have just a thank you to the high tea. There's like 40 ladies that showed up here last Wednesday to do the teetotaler thing. And I think I heard it was wonderful. It was a wonderful time to be together. And so thank you for those of you that put that whole thing together. It was very, very worthwhile. I didn't know there were so many different hats. There's a gal here with like 200 hats. Vintage hats. I'm glad you are wearing a hat today. There's nothing. There's no one wearing a hat today. That used to be the thing, you know, many years ago, but not today. So altar guilds, if you got any questions on being a part of that, kind of make it into little pieces. It doesn't have to be a whole thing, a big commitment, but just, you know, once a month it happens, and you can do it however you want to do it. See Al Lickhart if you would like to be a part of the Altar Guild, which is a lot of centered around communion and the colors and oiling the candles, those kinds of things. But you can see Al if you want to. Al, raise your hand just so we know who you are. Okay. If you don't know Al, then
get to know him.
Vacation Bible School, it's coming closer and closer. We hope that you can make a part of that. You notice there is something in the fellowship hall that's a big cardboard thing. That's the beginning of the cave that Daniel is going into, and we got a life-size painting of Daniel in the storage room, and I hope he's not too lonely in there. But they'll be coming out for you to see on Vacation Bible School. That will begin on July 31st through August 3rd, and so just keep that in mind as well. I feel like I'm forgetting something here.
Hey,
yeah.
I think maybe we ought to do a regular potluck thing on Wednesdays. Give Dean a little break. He might still be laying low after this fall. That's Wednesday.
Okay. I think we should put Karen Dockin in charge of that potluck. Wednesday night, okay, it'll just be a potluck. Leave Dean off the hook, is what you're saying?
Yeah.
And you're going to be in charge. That's what you're saying. Thank you so much, Jeff. Appreciate that. And I think we kind of, Merle Johnston is put on hospice this week. And I went to see him, and he doesn't know who I am, and he would not invite me in his house. But I told him Nancy Letcher and Linda Johnson know him, and he knows you as well. And so he goes, I know who they are, but I don't know who you are, and you're not coming in my house. He's got a little bit of dementia as well, and his son-in-law was there, so I mean, it wasn't all that bad. But just want you to know that Merle, he used to come here before COVID, with an oxygen thing he'd carry with him, but now he's on oxygen at his house, and he's up and around type of thing, but he's on hospice. So keep him in your prayers, as well as Chuck and Bob Griffiths and Dean Ramsey, and on it goes. And let's pray right now, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you for everyone that is here today. Thank you for those that are on Zoom, that come from who knows how many miles away, and we thank you for those that traveled a number of miles to get here today as well. Thank you, Lord, for those that live here in Milford and those that live in Arnold's Park and Okoboji and Spirit Lake and surrounding area. It's just good to be together today. And we lift up to you, Lord, those that are that have needs that we know that only you can really provide and that you can meet. You may use us as visiting and encouraging or sending a card or whatever it is, but Lord, we know that you are the great physician, and you can do the impossible that we just don't think is possible. And so we lift them up to you today. We've mentioned them by name here this morning, and we just pray that they would know that you are there with them. Your word says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I'll be with you. And Lord, we trust in your word. And thank you for all that is here today, as well as the praise band as well. In your name we pray. Amen.
Crown him with many crowns. I invite you to stand as we sing this song together, ever mindful of the kingship of Jesus. Here we go.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem crowns, the music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave, who rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring, and lives that death may die. Crown him the Lord of heaven, one with the Father known, one with the Spirit through him dim, from yonder glorious throne to thee be endless praise, for thou for us hast died. Be thou, O Lord, through endless days adored and magnified.
You may be seated.
Our responsive reading today comes from Hebrews and 1 Peter, where it says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus. And that's why we're here today, isn't it? Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith.
Who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God.
Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
In his great mercy, he has given new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
All my obsessions, I want to lay them all down in your hands. Only your love is vital, though I'm not entitled, still you call me your child. God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to take my hands off of my life and the way it should go. God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to open my hands up and give you control. Yeah, I give you control.
I've had plans shattered and broken, things I have hoped in fall through my hands. You have plans to
redeem and restore me. You're behind and before me. Oh, help me believe.
And God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to take my hands off of my life and the way it should go. Oh, God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to open my hands up and give you control.
Somehow you want me. The King of Heaven wants me. So this world has lost its grip on me. Oh, you want me. Somehow you want me. The King of Heaven wants me. So this world has lost its grip on me. God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to take my hands off of my life and the way it should go. God, you don't need me, but somehow you want me. Oh, how you love me. Somehow that frees me to open my hands up and give you control.
God, you want me, but somehow you want me.
The King of Heaven wants me. So this world has lost its grip on me.
You want me.
Somehow you want me. The King of Heaven wants me. So this world has lost its grip on me.
Thank you. Praise band can be seated. You can leave the platform. That's a wonderful thought. Somehow God doesn't need us, but he wants us to serve him, to be a light for him. And so that's really what it's all about. None of us are irreplaceable. Pastors come and pastors go. How many pastors have you seen in your life or been a part of? The time will come when I too will one day announce, sayonara, which means my time here is gone as well. So at any rate, God will always take care and be here with you no matter what. I invite you to stand as we come to the place where God wants us to focus on here today. It's Matthew chapter 13. It's a lot longer than, I shortened it down because I just don't like long passages. It's kind of like I like dessert first rather than the main meal. But Matthew chapter 13, 1 through 3a, and then we jump down to verses 10 and 11. And I like to read in Jesus' name here today. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. How many of you have done that in the last little while? Sat by the lake. Well, Norma, you live right by the lake. And such large crowds gathered around Jesus that he had to get into a boat. And he sat in it. And while all the people stood on the shore, then he told them many things in parables. Go down to verse 10 and 11. The disciples came to him and asked, "Why do you speak to the people in parables?" And Jesus replied, "The knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, but not to them." Interesting. Secrets of heaven given to the people by Jesus through parables. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, use this time in our lives that we can say that we've spent time with you today. We've heard you. We've heard your voice. We heard your teaching. May we respond to what you have for us today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. You have to picture it in your mind. Jesus is sitting in a boat because the crowds have come. They are standing on the shoreline, and so he is teaching by parables. It's a kind of one of the first things we see how Jesus speaks to people by using parables. Reminds me of what I heard this past week of a person who told me that, you know, life is like a roll of toilet paper. I'm going, what are you talking about? Life is like a roll of toilet paper. The closer you get to the end, the faster it goes. And there's a lot of truth to that. Life is like that. As children, we think time goes by so, it takes forever to get to Christmas again or to your birthday. The older you get, you're going like, wow. It's that time already. It happens that way. Jesus is one of the master storytellers, and he uses parables as a way of being able to communicate something simple to teach a truth to his audience. And so that's what you got to just kind of remember. The parables that he teaches, he will use something very familiar with his audience, but he's going to make a point in what he says. And that's what we have here before us today. I didn't read the parable that he gave there, but if you want to know what it is, it has to do with a farmer who went out to sow seed, and he went out and he scattered. He was broadcasting it. He was scattering the seed, and the seed fell in different places. And then after he says that, well, then the disciples say, "Lord, what are you talking about? Explain to us what you just said to the people." And he does that. Now, we'll get into that here this morning as well. If you look at verse 13, if you do have a Bible or if you can put it on your phone, if you're following along on your iPhone these days, but if you're playing a game on your iPhone, you better put it away. So, verse 13, it says, "This is why I speak to them in parables. Though seeing, they do not see. Though hearing, they do not hear or understand." And it goes on, it says, "In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah." So what Jesus is doing here on the Sea of Galilee with the crowd of people on shore, it is a fulfillment of what Isaiah said about 600 years earlier of what's going to take place. And so Jesus teaches by storytelling, by using parables. And Isaiah said this in Isaiah chapter 6, verses 9 and 10. "You will be ever hearing, but never understanding." Sound like anyone here that's been going to church for a long time? You come, but do you understand anything? Does anything make an impact on your life over the years? Isaiah says, "You will be ever hearing but never understanding. You will ever seeing but never perceiving. For this people's heart has become calloused. They hardly hear with their ears." Anybody have problems hearing? If you look at the back of the head of someone sitting in front of you, if you see something around the ears, it's probably a hearing aid. The person has trouble hearing. Now, women, you can't tell because they got longer hair. If they have closed, you know, if they hardly hear with their ears and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and turn and I would heal them. That's what Isaiah says. You know what a callus is? A callus is kind of like a blister. It's somebody that uses their hands a lot, hardworking. They get blisters, and over time, the blister will become a hard skin area. You can get a little stick pin, and you can stick it into a callus that you have on your hand. You even pull it right through your callus, and you don't feel a thing. It's hard skin. And Jesus talked a lot about a heart that is calloused, a hard heart. We need to have a tender heart, one that's sensitive to what Jesus says and what God's word says to us. They hardly hear with their ears and they close their eyes, so they've got a hearing problem and sometimes they can't see clearly either. We have, Bob was telling us that today. He can't see that back there like he used to. If you got glasses today, it's probably because you can't see good either. Either got far, you're far distance person or you're a nearsighted person. You need glasses to help you to see. I hope God's word here today will help you to see what he wants you to learn about him today. The parables will help us understand the secrets of God. Did you know that there are 23 parables in the book of Matthew alone? In Mark's gospel, there are only 9 parables. In Luke's gospel, there's 27 or 28 parables, 15 which you do not find in Matthew or Mark. So Jesus used a lot of parables in communicating. And so the interpretation of the parable of the sower is really pretty simple. The focus is not the seed, even though that's important. It's the farmer, but he's not the focus either. The focus is the type of soil that the seed falls on. And so Jesus wants to be able to communicate to the crowd where everyone begins to ask themselves, what kind of a soil am I? That's what he really wants to communicate to these people. That they leave saying, what kind of a soil am I? How have I received God's word in my life? Am I rocky soil? Am I a hard path kind of a person? Am I one that's got it's on good ground, but there's a lot of thistles and weeds that come and choke out God's word? Or am I good ground? At least I want to be good ground, and I'm learning along the way. And we know that, you know, with seed, when it's planted, it takes time, doesn't it? You just don't get something overnight, just like cucumbers. You don't get cucumbers overnight. You got to plant the seed. It's like with potatoes. It's anything that you plant in the garden, you got to wait before it will produce. And it's that way in the Christian walk too. It takes time in order for us to bear fruit. And there's some of us who aren't bearing fruit. Been a Christian a long time, and there's been no fruit. And you have to ask yourself, why is that? How can I be a Christian for over 10 years and don't see any fruit? Well, that's kind of convicting. Let's move on. Okay. What we have here in this parable with the sower is you've got a path. Many of you are familiar with what a path is. It's if you come from a farm background, Or if you've been out someplace like in a state park, you'll find a path you walk on. It's hard. Any seed that will fall on a path, it cannot penetrate the soil. You know, it just will not grow. It'll just stay there and the birds will come and eat it, if anything does. And Jesus makes a point that, you know, when you hear God's word, the devil likes to come and snatch it away. He doesn't want you to come to know Christ as your Savior. He doesn't want you to grow as a Christian. But Jesus does. There's rocky soil. You know, it's got good soil, but mixed with a lot of rocks. It's shallow. You can't put much root down in it. A lot of times in North Dakota, you'd find the hilltops are a lot like this. Clay and rocky. And you do not get much grain off the hills, the top of hills. You get your big bushels down in the valley, down in the low spots, where the rain can sit and sink in and soak in for a while. But in a rocky soil, there's no way for moisture to be retained. When the sun comes up, it withers because there's no root. The good soil, but it's full of thistles and thorns or weedy ground. The seed gets choked out because there's competition. And the competition is pretty tough. You don't get much produce either from your grain in a weedy patch. I grew up where we had trouble with Canadian thistle. I'm not being racist here, or like I mean, I'm not saying I don't like Canadians, but that's what we call it, Canadian thistle. Or Creepy Jenny. And wherever that was at, it would just crowd out any kind of seed. And a lot of times you'd have to either pick up your swather or you pick up the header of your combine and go over it because you don't want to get that seed mixed in with the good seed that's in the hopper. But then there's a good soil that produces, and you notice what it produces. Some places it's 30 times more than what you planted. Some it says it's 60 times more. And then some says it's 100 times more. We would call that a bumper crop. A bumper crop when you just get a lot of grain. More than what you thought. Jesus ends his parables oftentimes by saying this. He who has ears, you can touch your ears, you got them. Everybody here's got ears. And it's not just for the guys, it's also for the women. He who has ears, let him hear. Are you listening? Not just to me, listening to what God is wanting to say to you this morning. It is here where the disciples take Jesus alone. And sometimes Jesus will tell his disciples, give them more of an interpretation, go into a little more detail of what he just said to the crowds, to explain to them what he was talking about. So on one level, parables are not difficult or hard to understand because Jesus taught moral principles by using simple, down-to-earth illustrations about everyday objects familiar to farmers, fishermen, merchants, and others in his audience. Today, he'd have to probably use something that goes along with computers, high-tech kind of stuff. Because a lot of the younger people are in that and are aware of what that is all about. But at the same time, the spiritual lessons of a parable seem to be hidden to those who didn't like Jesus. Those who were opposed to Jesus really did not understand his parables. Those who were truly interested in seeking the truth, they received spiritual insight. And they got the meaning from the parables. So some saw Jesus' parables as fascinating, but only puzzling riddles. There are others who really didn't hear anything. They were there because everybody else was going there, following the crowd. And so there were times where Jesus, in private with his disciples, he would provide his disciples with more detailed explanations. And we find here that it's God's intent that certain secrets of the kingdom be kept somewhat hidden to the casual observer, the nonchalant seekers, and the opponents. They just didn't get it. They didn't catch the meaning of these parables. But the parables are there to get people's attention. Does the Lord have your attention this morning by just this one parable of with the sower and the seed? The kingdom advances slowly and challenges the hearers to ask themselves, what kind of soil am I? That's the question to ask yourself right now. What kind of soil am I? When the seed that I hear, how is it planted in my heart? Hebrews 4, verse 12 says this. It's a great verse. The word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates. Now, the path you can't penetrate, seed cannot penetrate the path, something that's hard. But here it says, God's word penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Yikes! God's word is that powerful. It knows your attitudes and your thoughts. God knows where you have gone outside of this church building since you've been here, thinking about whatever or wherever you've gone. Romans chapter 10, verse 17 says this, that without hearing God's word, there is no faith. Faith is always tied to what God's word says to us. Romans 10, 17 says, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ. How important is God's word? Well, we find in Matthew 24, 35, it says that Jesus is speaking now. We know he doesn't lie. And Jesus says this about God's word. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. His word is eternal. Wow. So does he have your attention this morning? What kind of a soil are you? Let's pray. Lord, there's probably been many times in our lives where we've said, we know that I don't want to be a path. I don't believe I'm that hard-hearted. But yet, this morning, as I look inwardly at my life, I don't see much of any results. Even though I've been coming to church or going to church many years, many times. Lord, I'm not as deep in knowing Jesus as I should be. My roots are shallow. It's only when there is a good rain or when things are easy that I seem to like that. But when things get a little difficult, I leave you and I start taking things into my own hands. And I'll do what I want to do rather than relying on you. And then, Lord, too, there's that thistle patch, the weedy patch. Getting caught up on the things of this world and worries and what have you, and there's plenty of those that will always be there. They will always come. But Lord, don't let them crowd out your word in my life. I want to be good soil. Help me to be faithful, patient, and kind, and the fruits of the Spirit, I know that they're at work. May not have all of them, but I do desire them. Forgive me for the times that I just take life as I see it rather than as you see it. What you want to do in my life to make me more mature in my faith. Forgive me, Lord, for becoming deaf and not seeing the bigger picture. So, Lord, today we have heard just a little bit about the seed and the sower, the four types of soil, and what happens when the seed penetrates. Or tries to penetrate. May that give us encouragement, or may it give us something to chew on and to think about here when we leave this church today. So may we pray the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Why did we just pray that prayer? If anything, it's for the younger kids. Some of them don't know that prayer. Some of them will come to learn it as more and more they hear it. And what is it that you hear probably prayed at a graveside service when life is over? It's that prayer. It's probably the last thing that draws people together in the remembrance of someone whom they love who dies. It takes on a whole new meaning. So I invite you to stand as we recite the Apostles' Creed together as well. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. And as you are being seated or sitting down, just want you to know how much I love you, I care about you, and if that's me, God loves you a whole lot more than I do. And so may you go and serve him wherever he calls you and wherever you live. He wants to use you because he cares and loves you as well. Go in his peace.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, we will roll. Will you please stand as we celebrate on that bright and cloudless morning? Oh, the bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of the resurrection share, when the chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is gone. The first verse once more. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the chosen ones are gathered to their home beyond the shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Go in peace and serve the Lord.